I'm Professor Adam Teman of the EnICS Labs at Bar-Ilan University, and now we'll be continuing with our RTL to GDS demo, going on to part 4, which is place and route on a simple block. So let's start. At this point, we have written our RTL, performed at least very basic functional verification, synthesized our design, and run gate-level simulation and power estimation. It's now time to move on to the physical domain. So for this, we're going to be using Cadence Innovus. So what is Cadence Innovus? Innovus is Cadence's place and route tool. It encapsulates several other Cadence tools, including GigaPlace for timing-driven placement, CCOpt for timing-driven clock tree synthesis, NanoRoute for timing-driven routing, QRC for sign-off quality parasitic extraction, Tempus for sign-off quality static timing analysis, and Voltus for electromigration and IR drop analysis and power estimation. So to start Innovus, we are going to run it in stylus common UI mode in this tutorial. So we run Innovus minus stylus. That will start us with the stylus common UI mode. So all of the commands that I'm going to be showing are according to the stylus common UI mode. If I had not put on the stylus minus stylus over here, it would start in legacy mode and the commands are slightly different. This will create two files in our working directory. One of them is called innovus.log, and it logs all of the things that happen and are shown on the screen. The other one is innovus.command, and innovus.command has all of the commands that we run. These will be add a number over here, like log1, log2, etc., if we run another run from the same directory. So we're always going to be at the latest innovus.log and innovus.command file. So now that we've finished our synthesis and our verification and everything, we can come and we can start to do our physical design, which we do inside Innovus. So Innovus by default at these versions still runs in legacy mode. We're going to run it with common UI. So we add the minus stylus flag to open Innovus, and then it's going to go and it's going to check out our license. So Innovus loads its UI. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to go into my scripts folder and find the innovus.tickle. And the first line that I actually had is GUI set UI main minus geometry. And what that is going to do, it's going to resize my screen, which I'm going to run over now. And you can see that the UI now is exactly the size that I wanted. The reason that I'm showing you this, I'm using it for the recording to maximize the screen size over here for the recording. But the reason I'm showing you this is that we can really find commands that do almost everything in our UI. These are in the different user manuals and so forth. And you can run helps and man commands and so forth. But this GUI set UI main minus geometry just resized the screen. So anything pretty much I can do here. Some of them are spit out into the command file. So I just want to show you also that we have inside our folder, just like in Genus and in every other tool basically in this flow, we have a log file and a command file, and we can look inside the command file to see everything that we've run pretty much. So you can see different things that are spit out. So when you do things like, for example, I will now uncheck all of these layers. Okay, and it did this set layer preference node layer is visible 0. So that's something that I could take into my script. And again, if I look inside my command file, I will see that that command was run. And what that did is it changed something in the UI. Probably if I change the command over here to have a 1, it will reset everything that I just unset. So let's take that and change this to a 1. And then go back into my UI and I'll see that these boxes were checked. So I can really control the whole UI from the scripts. And that can be very useful in order to make my flow and make my script changing different things. Here's a brief overview of the Innovus graphical user interface. So at the top, we have what we call the menu commands. These are all kinds of icons for different commands, such as opening a design, selecting and highlighting things, zooming around, and different things like that. All kinds of tools like the design browser and the violation browser that we're going to be talking about. So all of these are different icons over here. We can also open most of them from these menus around here. Then we have the view area. Now this is very important. This toggles the three different views we have over here. The first one is called the floor plan view, and that we'll be using during floor planning. Then we have the amoeba view, which shows kind of after placement where the different standard cell modules are placed. And the third one is called the placement view, and that we'll be using after placement for all the place and route. We'll be using that most of the time actually. Next, we have the very important layer control window. So this window over here, this form that's docked on the right over here, it allows us to select and to view different parts of the design. So the most important thing are the layers. So we have metal one, via one, metal two, etc. So by clicking under the V, we view or make those layers disappear. And by clicking under the S, we make them selectable or not selectable. Of course, pressing the top one will select or deselect all of the check marks underneath. The rest of them are all kinds of other things that we have in our design. And we'll see that throughout the tutorial, different things that we can click on or not and what will happen exactly. And this will be very useful for doing different things in our design. Next, we have the toolbox. So these are all kinds of icons that can be useful. Some of them are more useful, some of them are less useful. For instance, this is for moving a standard cell. This is the ruler. So there are all kinds of other tools over here. Next, we have the select bar. So under here, if we select a certain instance or a net or something, the name will come out over here and then we can use it. We can copy and paste it to a script, all kinds of things like that. Here, the coordinates of where our mouse is will be shown. And there are all kinds of other different things which are shown in the select bar. Finally, we have the wire editing toolbar. So that's if you want to go and do wire editing, like push polygon type of layout editing. We don't use it very often, maybe some bit during routing. You can actually remove any of these tools by right-clicking somewhere on one of these menus and deselecting, for example, wire edit. It'll give us a little bit more space on our design. We can also look at our command log and see what the commands were for turning these on and off, and we can put it in a script that it will happen automatically. So now going back to this UI, we backend people and in general engineers don't usually like UIs, but place and route is very visual. So we do have to use the GUI for a lot of things. So I just want to go and give you a quick overview of what we have here. So similar to different Windows type programs, we have, you know, the menu over here with file, view, edit, and all of these forms. And inside you can open different forms that do things. Even though we're going to run almost everything from a script, the way to figure out the easiest way, I guess, rather than looking through all the manuals and so forth, to figure out what command you want to run is first time you do it, run it from one of these forms and then look at the command file that we had over there and see what the command is that was written out, and then go, for instance, using the user manual and all kinds of application notes from Cadence support and so forth, to go and configure that exactly how we want it to be run in our script. So that's the first thing. The second thing is we have these different toolbars which we can select and deselect what we want to see by right-clicking and then selecting which ones we want to show and don't want to show. So these are different things that we can do, and we'll be seeing some of them throughout the flow. And then on the second line over here, we have some wire editing tools. Most of them we aren't going to use. We can even like close something like this. Oops. The toolbox over here, we can even close some of the things like this. On the left side here was the wire editing. We're not going to usually use those. So if you don't like these things, again, you can add to your script some commands to remove these things automatically when you open your tool. On the right hand side, we have a couple of things here that are very important. Well, actually, I guess I do need the toolbox over here, because there are three important buttons over here. This is called the floor plan view, and we don't see anything now. This is called the amoeba view, and this one is called the physical view. We also have this cool new thing where you can look at things in 3D. But we're going to really have to move between floor plan view and physical view when we do our floor planning, and afterwards when we place and route our design, we're going to move over to the physical view to see what the actual thing is. The amoeba view kind of shows how all the modules and so forth are placed inside the design, so we'll look at that a little bit later. And on the right hand side over here, we have the different selection boxes, and there are a lot of things that can be selected and deselected here. The one that we're going to most commonly use is selecting all these metal layers. You see that there are 31 metal layers. That is not what we have in our technology, because we haven't loaded any technology. We've just loaded the tool. But there are lots and lots of options over here, and we'll go over some of them, see what you can do with the different things. But in general, you often have to go and play around with viewing and unviewing different ones of them to see what you want. Another thing is you have on the bottom over here some toolbars that tell us what is selected and what the coordinates are we are in the design and all kinds of things like that. So this is the UI. So now I'm going to go over the project structure. Just as a reminder, I have a deep dive into this in the overview of Project Workspace, the first basically video in this series. And so what our project workspace consists of, in my methodology at least, we have whatever the root of our project is. That's the directory where everything starts from. And we have all these subdirectories over here. So starting from workspace where everything is run from, then we have the source code directory, which will have our RTL files and our test bench files underneath it. We have the inputs directory. That's going to have specific files for this design that make all kinds of definitions. So the inputs are inputs to this design, and we have to really edit all of the files under there for this design in particular. On the other hand, the libraries file is going to be pretty generic for our for the technology that we're using. So it has all the different definitions of where the libs and lefts and so forth are. The scripts directory is going to be a directory of scripts for each of the tools that we run. So this video is going to talk about the Innovus.tickle script. So Innovus is the tool we're going to be running mainly. So that's going to be inside the scripts. We also saw Genus.tickle is in there, and all kinds of other scripts are going to be under the scripts directory. Apps we're going to be discussing in the next part of the lecture series. Reports are where all the reports are dumped to. So just one place where we can put all the reports. They're going to be inside there. And export are all the files that are exported along the way, you know, different parts of data that we write out. There's also a DBs file where we put in the databases themselves that we can reload into Innovus. And the docs directory is a good place to put all kinds of documentation that can help us with our flow or whatever. So that is basically our project workspace. That's how the directory structure is built. With that, we have these tickle arrays that I like to use, and we have four important ones that I set up. The first one is design, and that has everything that has to do with the design, like design top level is the top level name of the design that we are working on. Then we have paths and tech files. So the paths are the paths where we have our different files stored inside our server, basically. And tech files are the actual files at the end of the path. So for example, what the left files are, lib files are, and so forth. Tech are going to be specific variables about this technology. They're mostly going to be defined inside the library's scripts. Okay, so design is going to be mostly defined inside the input scripts. Tech is going to be mostly designed inside the defined inside the library scripts. Actually, tech files are going to be defined mostly there. And finally, we have this debug.txt file, which is a file that I print out with a little script that helps us really debug all kinds of problems that we have in here. So when we're setting up our design at the early stages, we're going to have a lot of bugs and different little typos in paths and in file names and so forth. And it really helps to have a long printout of all the different way that the different lists and variables were built. So you can find those immediately in the debug.txt file instead of writing some sort of puts or something like that to show what a certain variable is. So just the last point is that we run everything from the workspace directory, and that makes it really easy to start another run without removing another. We can take this workspace directory and just go kind of like, be careful with this, rm-rf*, and really erase everything inside. There's nothing that's part of the design that's under this hierarchy. We can also just make a workspace 2 and make another run there and keep all the log files and everything that was created within that run. So it really makes the fact that this is in parallel to everything else, it makes it easy to just start over by creating another workspace or removing all the files that are underneath this workspace from a run that we want to get rid of. So going back into our Innovus.tickle script, the first things we do are, you know, setting up the kind of run similar to what we did in Genus and actually in Voltus as well. So set design top level SM is going to give us our top level name. We need to set that for the scripts we're going to be running. And then we have different things like set run type place and route PNR. That's going to be used in different files over here that we use it as a condition to see if we're in synthesis in place and route or other parts of the design. And the debug file that is going to write out all of the variable values as we saw before during Genus. Okay, so we're gonna copy those three commands over to our terminal. And then we have our procedures file that we ran before, and it's the same file that we used in Genus. Sometimes, depending on if we're in PNR or in synthesis, there will be a bit different procedures because the tools aren't always consistent with the same commands and the same options in the commands, even though since they went over to the common UI, the stylus common UI,
the functions and most of the commands are very similar between all of these tools, Genus and Innovus and Tempus and Voltus. Okay, and then we have this start stage, which all it does is it really does some cleanup over here. It tells us what the current time is and what the host name is and what the log file and the command file are, because these are things that are going to change. And if we want to go look through our log file afterwards and see, you know, different types of things, we can see it because of this cleanup that's kind of written into our log file. So this is just the starting stage, and we start by reading in our defines file, which we used before, that sets up most of our design definitions, our design array. Okay, and then we have the basic technology things, the standard cell things. So we load those, and then we have other things that we'll be showing in a further video when we go at the full chip level. Right now, we're just at the macro level. There's a simple block. So we're not going to be reading in, we're not going to be using quite a bit of the things. This is an intro kind of to a very simple design. And later on, we will have a video that is going to go onto more complicated designs that will have more features. Finally, we do this debug file stuff. So I'm going to print that type of stuff out. And just to see what that is, I can look inside that debug.txt file, which is now inside my workspace, and I can see that there are values for every single one of these different types of variables that I set. Just for example, run type equals PNR. So these things are printed out so I can easily go and debug things when different types of things break without trying to go and see which variable set, which variable set, which variable, etc. So that's why I keep this for cleanup.